make the start, please. Okay, can I welcome everybody to this special cabinet meeting to deal with a number of outstanding items. Thanks everybody for their attendance. Can I just start off by asking for Councillor Tony Smith's apologies to be recorded? Tony's away today. I just want to deal with one announcement, really, at the start before we get into the main business. And it's a good news, well, it's a couple of good news stories, really. I'd just like to, before we have minuted, because I think they deserve to be, if I could ask Councillor Bernie Mooney, first of all, to say a little bit about the training standards award that we recently received.
Last week we went to London where our training standards department were awarded the MJ National Award, so it's a national award, not a local award, for the E-Ground Takeaway for Change project that they run through the Rock Ferry School in Birkenhead. It was a project where they talked to local families about eating healthily and asking them what their food habits were. Some of the families ate at local takeaways, so the next stage of the project was to work with the local takeaways to do things like changing the fat that they cook chips in and using less salt and using different types of ingredients, fresher ingredients. They went back to the families and asked that their best meals were things like chicken, sweet and sour, or fish and chips. And following that, the takeaways that changed were given vouchers for these families to go away and try the healthier option. Out of 285, 214 families took part in this project. They went back, tasted the healthier options. The majority of them enjoyed the healthier options and said they would continue eating the healthier options. So it was a massive, massive, massive success. And that's why the award was won, because of the potential it has for changing the lives and changing the eating habits of school children and families. This project is going to be rolled out now. We were planning to do it anyway, but on the back of the awards, it's going to be rolled out to what we think is 10 more schools on the roll, but it's gained an awful lot of response nationally because of the awards and because people are now aware of the Healthy Eating Project. So Colin Clayton's a manager over there, but it was the brainchild of Nikki Pulford, and I think everybody over in that department has worked really, really, really well. And I'd like to congratulate them for all the hard work. It's well, well, well deserved. And once again, it's something that shows that we're a Borough Council, are a very positive council, and doing some very positive things in what are very difficult times for us. So I want to thank everybody who was involved and congratulate them.
I think, can I add my congratulations as well to the team, because it was a fantastic achievement to have, as you say, national recognition for that great project. It is being, I know, looked at now by a whole range of other local authorities doing a similar type of scheme elsewhere. So, we can formally register our thanks and congratulations to the whole team. That would be great. So thanks for that, Bernie. Thank you. And we have another positive announcement, which I'm going to ask Ann McLachlan to talk a little bit about.
Yeah,
thanks, Chair.
And you may recall that the last cabinet, I mentioned that our corporate risk team, one of our officers was up for a national award, the Alarm Award, Association of Local Authority Risk Managers, and the award ceremony was to be held last week, and we won the award. And I think, that's kind of the icing on the cake from the point of view of us being recognised nationally as being at the top of the game in terms of risk management. We've got a risk management team who not only roll out across the council, but across all the local authorities. They are using and utilising, the expertise that we've developed. We are a nationally recognised authority in terms of being able to manage risk against the authority. And of course, that saves us thousands of pounds a year. We claim to be taken against the authority. So again, I would like to add my congratulations to Simon Hutchinson and the team. But it's a whole team effort. I wouldn't want to be specifically named himself,
the leading light in local government. So I echo your congratulations. And I'm sure the whole cabinet would send good wishes and congratulations to the whole of the corporate team. So thanks for that. That's great. Okay, so I just wanted to formally celebrate really those successes and those awards. So thank you for bearing with us. So go to the agenda. Item one is the Members' Code of Conduct, Declarations of Interest. Any members of Cabinet wish to declare an interest? Stuart?
With the personal and registered prejudicial interest in agenda item 7, but I urge you, I've lived with the Wallasey and also the Liverpool interest.
Great. I will record a personal prejudicial interest in item number 3, the local welfare assistance scheme, because the Wirral Food Bank is explicitly referred to and mentioned as a possible beneficiary, and I am a trustee of Wirral Food Bank. So I will vacate the room when that item comes up and ask Anne to chair the cabinet for that particular item. Okay. Any other declarations of interest any other cabinet members wish to declare? Okay. So that then takes us then to item 3, the local welfare assistance scheme, and I'm going to leave at this point and over to you, Anne. Thank you.
Take people who came here for food, whereas we've 7 days from where from. So
7 day, morning for all 7 days worth of food. We'll be back, said they would take the first 3 days from us, and therefore that would reduce how much we gave the people for an award. The proviso was if people did not live near a local food bank, we would give them the whole 7 days so we could go to a supermarket. Project Energy, Energy Project Plus have a pot of money there from local gas and electricity companies. They said to send anyone there who's in fuel debt, and they can have £25 more of payments to pay off that fuel debt. It also set more, give them some debt advice around future fuel, because fuel poverty is a massive problem as well, a big problem in the world. We said we continue to work on the food bank, which we've asked on that, can't see. That we would review this in a year's time, which would be just under a year now. And obviously we were hoping at the time that we could lobby for more funding, and maybe there might have been a change in government, which hasn't happened. So we don't know where we're going to be in a year's time, but we'd certainly like to review how our recommendations have, how they panned out and whether there's any money left and what we could do with that, of course. And we also, the officers and the panel spoke about applications for white goods, fridges, freezers, the washing machines, Energy Project Plus have a kitty for that as well. So we said that we would, unless a very extreme circumstance, maybe a family, children, or being domestic violence, we would automatically refer someone there if they put in an application for more for a fridge. So that's quite good, that's quite a lot of money that we saved. And one of our recommendations, was that we continue to lobby central government for further funding, really. But I think it was a great piece of work. It showed scrutiny at its best. And I think we're up as well, because I've just come back from a training course in Birmingham Council, but we're on chair and scrutiny. And there were councillors from all around the country there, and I think by far and away, we actually need in the way of scrutiny, judging from what everyone else was telling us, what they do, what they don't do. So I thought it was a great piece of work. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Dr. Jeanette. Thank you. Colleagues, anybody want to? Bernie.
Jeanette, I agree. This is a great, great, great piece of work, and it's great that it's sort of cross-party with everybody who's involved or partnering. The only thing I want to ask you is about working with other partners. You mentioned a couple of other partners. Will there be any other partners involved in this, and how are we going to monitor what we're doing with other partners if we know that?
Well, we're going to, and the officers are going to keep in constant communication with Energy Project Plus and Wirral Food Bank. They were the two main ones identified. CAB, we agreed to have better communication last week, because the feedback we had from them was that people still aren't aware that the local welfare assistance scheme exists, which would probably account for the very late income when we first started it. But the two main ones would be Project Plus and the Food Bank, and officers have agreed to ask you to keep in constant contact and meet up with them to monitor how things go.
I'd just like to comment on how utterly regrettable it is that any council has had to take measures of this sort. It's an indictment of the government that this sort of thing is necessary. And I must say that I'm pleased that there has been a cross-party approach to this on this council. But it's perhaps one of the meanest of a very long series of despicable measures taken by this government that has made this necessary. And I'm glad that the Down Council has done something to try to offset the damage.
Just congratulations, really, for the work that's been done. And I think that the partnership work that you've started hopefully will be making a huge difference to a lot more people on Wirral.
Thanks, Pat.
Yeah, again, congratulations. It's a full innovation, this piece of work, it really is. And I think it's great to see one partners, only one practice, really stepping up to the place. I know you've got all the feedback for Energy Plus, and I think that's a really great way of doing things. Bringing in partners and they're helping out in terms of the funding, the white goods and bits and pieces of fuel, fuel policy you mentioned as well. Can I ask our other ones, because that's what we're looking at, aren't we? At our local as a council, looking at bringing in partners and something coming up, etc. I mean, we really need to step up to the plate, and they need to step up to the plate over the next 2 or 3 years, which is what we're doing and what we're looking at. And look, building on those relationships, and that's the important thing, building on those relationships with the new way of working.
Out there, I think it would be fantastic if we could collaborate with them. What we did have mentioned are some small, sort of isolated, very tiny charities that we mentioned, but at this point in time, we chose to refer by customers that no other organisation delivers on that scale, so the word seemed to be kind of favouring them, maybe. But obviously, I mean, you know, it's an option for the future. It depends, I suppose, in a year's time, we're going to be talking about what's left in the kitty. And we don't know what the uptake's going to be if the, you know, it's true that tax credits are going to be slashed, and I suspect we're going to have pockets in New London, and it's just really heartbreaking. And I'd like just to say to Adrian and Chris, I'm really, really proud of this council and what we've done, because, you know, we found the funding to help those in most need on Wirral. And If my task and condition to play a small part and help a few more, then it's job done well, as far as I'm concerned.
George?
Yeah, thanks, Jenna. First of all, I want you in the camp, please, to reflect back to the people who helped you to come with this report. It's an excellent report, you've both thought through. It's got some really good information in it, and one of the ones that I just wanted to pick up on more than anything else. Will Food Bank, as a moment, has now got 14 outlets, and we're heading out now, we're into Hollywood as well as. So I just think that the next piece underneath the review panel, where it makes the point about citizen advisory, we were discussing this on last week, about the awareness of the local welfare assistance scheme, is only put out by word of mouth. And I don't know how we can actually address that better as a council, so that people who haven't come forward can come forward with confidence that they will be listened to when we get there.
I agree, actually. I was surprised during the evidence gathering that it wasn't a widely publicised scheme. So we have asked the AB to put information up in their offices. And similarly with the other parts that came. I think as more people need our assistance, the needs will spread, because invariably people will at some point find out this is where you now from when you used to apply for a crisis loan. But George, I agree, because the DWP, I mean, I had a phone call today, someone inquired about a crisis loan, and they haven't existed for 2 years. So it does take, I mean, it's one of those ones that we might need to see how the funding, what the take up is, and then look at that again about all the unfortunate thing about publicising the library is that the money's going to go quicker.
Absolutely.
You know, it is there for people in the need, so as long as you change people.
Absolutely. Okay.
Sure. Thanks, James. I just want to say that congratulations. We have having the first government scoop committee both as a panel member as well as a chair. I appreciate the amount of work that goes into tasking this piece of work, and the really valuable, evidence based policy. Congratulations, and maybe you can pass on comments. Just congratulations to the rest of the panel. We appreciate it.
Thanks, thank you.
Thanks. So just before I move to the recommendations, I mean, I think this is an excellent example of the kind of work that task and finish groups can do. Particularly delighted to read at the bottom of page 3 that the review panel was opposed to the government's decision to withdraw direct funding. You know, cross-party consensus about this. This is just vindicates everything that was said about us setting up these policy performance committees with the task and finish scrutiny work behind them. So I think this, you know, this is absolutely excellent piece of work, Juliet. I'm really pleased to see that the first recommendation is that we should keep hold of and administer ourselves on the basic necessities of food and fuel. And definitely recommendation 5, Cabinet will definitely welcome a further review there. And I think I understand the leader has written in the strongest terms already to the government to protest about the withdrawal of this grant. And we'll check on that. But just before I go to the recommendations, I mean, you know, as you said at the outset, this is about people in desperate need. helped us to make our money go a bit further by taking the first few days, by giving people some money towards their, you know, their fuel debt. All of that will help us to spread the amount of money we've got a bit further. So in the way that we have kept them, I'm having, you know, a summit in a couple of weeks with the business and other leaders of Wirral, maybe we could have a welfare summit with all of those agencies involved. I think that would be a way that we could bring everybody into the room who's got a pot of money and say, how can we do this better? You know, how can we help those people in the Wirral who are in desperate need? An absolutely excellent review. Thank you very much, Adrian. Please take the congratulations back to the committee. I'm just going to ask Heather Cavanagh now to read the recommendations as set out in Article
1. I just add one thing to it, if I can, please. In terms of the £900,000, could we have a review after 6 months just in case we have a massive takeover this year?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I think you will be taking reports to the transformation of resources on that anyway, won't you?
I mean, I can always help that board. Just to add on the back of this, it fell the whole unit to the government on the back of this report that we read.
Okay. Yeah, so we've got two additional recommendations that we have reviewed the money, that we rewrite to the government, that we endorse the recommendations of 9.1 and we approve the policy to come into force, the welfare assistance policy to come into force from August 2015. Which will fit very nicely with our new council plan currently under development.
Yeah.
So thank you very much. Can you cabinet agree that? Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Entitled to do under the legislation, there is scope for doing that.
And I'm clearly conscious of the fact that this model's been, or a similar model, not this precise one, has been used by certainly two London authorities that I'm aware of. And I think this is an attempt to provide a sort of financial incentive, particularly for those smaller businesses, the ones under 250 employees, to see if we can persuade them to become an accredited living wage employer. And in exchange for that, we're offering a discount on the business rates up to about £5,000. And, you know, I won't rehearse all the arguments why this is a good thing, but I think all the evidence now shows that organisations and businesses that adopt the living wage, their bottom line tends to improve, their staff tend to stay around for longer, sickness is less, retention is higher. So there's a good business case, I think, for adopting the living wage, which is one of the reasons we did it as a local authority. So the aim is to see if we can get the private sector now, some of the small businesses particularly, to buy into this scheme. And I think there is a, you know, there are a number of businesses I'm hoping that will take this up. I'm really pleased that the World Chamber of Commerce have agreed to promote this scheme with the businesses that are in their network. And I'm really looking forward to you know, businesses stepping up to the plate, really, and adopting the living wage. And, you know, I'm sure once one or two decide to take the that step, I think others will follow as well. So this is a bit of a, you know, a kind of a toe in the water, really, from our point of view, to try and pilot this. But I'm confident it will have a good take up. So formally, this is bringing the scheme to Cllr, because we asked for a more detailed scheme to be worked up, having put the money in our budget for 15-16, and I'm really pleased with the scheme that's been brought forward, and I'm really looking forward to many of our businesses now becoming living wage employers, because that is the best path, if you like, to families and individuals having a decent quality of life. So that, I think, is a really good. So, I suppose, just with those few words from me, I'm just formally asking Cllr to agree to those three recommendations in paragraph 13. Can you agree with that? Oh, Bernie, do you want to say a few words? Yeah. Of course, yeah.
I just want to add that I totally agree with this, and I think it's really, really good, but I think as a council we have to be aware of the knock-on effect of some of these policies as well, and start campaigning nationally on you work 16 hours and you're on the, you go on to the living wage, it takes you just beyond the £110 a week, allowance, that allows you to take carers allowance. So for people who are carers, who work just part-time, and who earn just under the 110, the living wage takes them over the 110, which means they lose all their carers allowance. I totally respect the living wage. I think it's a fabulous idea, because obviously not everybody's caring. But I do think we have to start campaigning on a national floor to say that things like, if you're a carer, you're a carer, and 110 is too low for them to live on the living wage. But to up their living standards, we have to up what they can claim in carers allowance. So I'm totally 1,000% in favour of this. But I do think as a council we have to start raising the issues of some of the other things that come out as a result of this.
Okay. Fair comment, and I'm off to the LGA conference this week, so because we've come all the way across. So maybe that's something the LGA, I'm sure, will take up, so that's fine. Okay, so formally, can we agree to those recommendations? Okay, so that takes us then to item 5, which is the Corporate Plan Performance Management Report. And Anne, will you take us through this, please?
Chair, this report sets out the current performance accounts against the Corporate Plan for the year end 2014-15. And I'll just speak to it's a report for noting, Chair, but I'll just speak to two exceptions for which the two graduated indicators, performance appraisals and the success rate. Can I just say on the performance appraisals, we fell some way short of our target on that, Chair. And I think that was partly fact that there was delays in terms of the impact of the remodelling programme and the delivery of that. But for 15-16, on that particular indicator, a new programme is being developed, and this will include a bespoke arrangement with each strategic directorate, led by a strategic director. So I think there'll be more emphasis on leadership from the top of the organisation to actually get through these particular performance appraisals across the organisation. So you know that's got a good action plan behind it. The other one on sickness absence rate, we actually missed our target here by a whisker, less than half a percentage point. But since the report's been prepared, I'm sorry that I haven't been able to circulate this to colleagues, it has been shared with me some benchmarking work that's been done with other authorities across the Northwest, and it does show that we are in the lower quartile for the average number of days absence. We're 7th out of 21. So, you know, 10.32, the lowest is 7.37, we're not so very far away from that. The direction of travel here as an organisation for us is in that direction towards that, you know, low number. I don't know how realistic it would be, Chair, in a large corporate organisation to say the ideal, you know, scenario would be no days sickness absence. Clearly, that would be the ideal scenario, but whether it's realistic is, you know, it does beg the question, really. So behind that again, there is an action plan to address that with our HR department. But I just want to say something general about performance management measures going forward, because the new council plan is under development at the moment, as you know, and alongside that will sit a whole lot of indicators. And it may well be that these particular indicators are not appropriate for us to be measuring. We really, you know, could be arguing that they are management, you know, they are management measures of how things are working with the staff. And you know, I would prefer going forward that we're looking at the corporate indicators that reflect how we're delivering against our council plan, really, across all of the portfolios. So I think that would be that would be a work in progress that's going on now. But this report is for noting, Chair. Or any questions?
Thanks for that, Anne. I think we will get a new suite of indicators and the council plan going forward. But I think we're just really being asked to note this report, unless there are any other questions that any members have got. So can we agree to know that?
Good evening.
Okay, thank you. Right, on to item 6, which is the Public Health Annual Report for 2014. And Chris, can you take us through this, please?
Thank you, Jay. I'm pleased to present you the Public Health Annual Report. This year's report is based on research carried out by the King's Fund entitled Improving the Public's Health. The Public Health Annual Report is a statutory document, and the Director of Public Health is required to produce such a report each year. The Council is required to publish it. It is intended to identify key issues for the borough and to support the councils and the partners' strategic thinking. There are 9 areas of action in the report. These align very closely with the issues that we as the Liverpool Labour Council have committed to take action on ourselves and provide a useful picture of good work that's going on, together with recommendations for action. And the 9 themes, I'm sure you've read the report, are the best start in life, healthy schools and pupils, helping people find good jobs and stay in work, active and safe travel, warmer and safer homes, access to green and open spaces and the role of leisure, strong communities, well-being and resilience, public protection and regulatory services, and health and spatial planning. What is evident from the report is the considerable contribution being made right across the council and with partners to these themes for action. The recommendations in summary ask us to think about how we can contribute and influence across the life force, and particularly how we can use our place-shaping responsibilities to create health-supporting environments. Additionally, the report looks back to the previous year's annual report, which focused on social isolation, and it is welcome to see just how widely action that issue has been supported by every sector across the Wirral and by our own neighbourhoods. So the recommendations for Cabinet are, through me, that the Director of Public Health requests and recommends that the content of the annual public report be approved for publication, and the Cabinet considers the recommendations of the report and reflects on how they can be incorporated into future council policy.
Okay, thanks Chris. I just add my support really for the contents of this report. I think, as you say, Chris, it very much reflects our priorities as an administration. I think it makes in several sections the point that, you know, it's really important to get the wider determinants of good health, you know, education, housing, etc. right. And I think that echoes our priorities. And, you know, lastly, I'd just like to sort of thank Fiona Johnson, our director, and her team for, you know, an excellent document and the work that they do. Certainly think since public health came back into the authority, it's definitely added value to the work we do. So well done to Fiona and her team and formally did that. Okay, so we're being asked, members, to notice and approve for publication the contents of the public health annual report for 2014. I think you've set out, Chris, how are we going to take the recommendations forward and incorporate into council policy. So that's just to agree those recommendations. Members, they agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, that takes us then on to the final item tonight. That's the item 7, Stuart, your party. Okay, so on to item 7, approval for council-wide officer to vote at AGM on proposal for BBCHA to merge with Liverpool Housing Trust. And George, will you introduce this, please, for us?
Thanks, Rob. This report seeks the support of Cabinet for proposals to undertake a transfer of engagements of Beechwood and Valentine Community Housing Association to Liverpool Housing Trust. It also sets out the ongoing dialogue which has been undertaken with tenants and lead petitioners following a petition which was presented to me as a Cabinet member immediately before Cabinet on the 4th of June, and a further petition was also submitted on the 18th of June. The proposal sets out the report following a review of BBCHA of its current arrangements to mitigate the financial risks it is exposed to as an organisation, and to ensure the long-term protection of services and investments. BBCHA is a relatively small organisation with just over 830 units of accommodation. It has met its commitments to invest in the stock in the years since transfer from the council and provides good service. It has been able to undertake this review from a position of strength. Nevertheless, financial challenges arise from its restrictive loan covenants, and particularly in addressing the impact of welfare reforms, which have limited its ability to invest in homes and services in the community. It is important that it reduces the amount it pays to meet operational and regulatory requirements in order to be able to increase investments. BBCHA has therefore considered a range of options and determined the most viable option was to transfer to LHT. Such a transfer would enable benefit from the existing relationships with BBCHA as with LHT, already provided in the form of support services such as IT and in similar staff terms and conditions, including pensions arrangements. LHT is also has existing strong relationships with the local authority through Property Bill Plus and its development activities. BBCHA have been in negotiations with LHT around the proposal and its board set up and negotiating power of independent and town board members. These have centred on a set of four key asks aimed at improving investment and services for the estate. This has formed the basis of a detailed business case which members have been provided with, available on a link referred to in the report. There are a range of headline benefits for the estate and the community which are set out in paragraph 3.4, including a commitment to new housing, to investment in the existing stock, and the repayment of outstanding loans, which will enable savings to be invested in the estate, together with the development and delivery of a neighbourhood master plan to address a wide range of issues across the estate. BBCHA undertook a formal 6-week consultation involving a wide range of tenants and stakeholders from the 26th of March to the 11th of May 2015. I have been handed two petitions from the tenants and residents of the Beechwood and Ballantyne area. I, along with members, officers and the council, BBCHA and LHC, have met with the lead petitioners to discuss all of their concerns. A meeting in the community has also been undertaken to give people every opportunity to ask questions and receive answers to any concern that they may have. Details of the consultation process are set out in section 5 and 6 of this report, and in the BBCHA board report and meeting notes included in the appendices to this report. Every tenant and stakeholder has been written to as part of the process, and a variety of events have taken place to give everybody the opportunity to participate. So in summary, the proposal to undertake a transfer of engagement from BBCHA to LHC will help to protect services on the estate through the ability to access resources from a larger organisation, at the same time increasing the level of financial resources to invest in Beechwood and Ballantyne. Proposals do not materially affect and will not reduce any other services and relationships that tenants and other commercial leaseholders and stakeholders currently benefit from the BBCHA. All the issues that have been raised by the petitioners, the meetings with lead petitioners and the community have been answered and addressed, and there are no valid outstanding concerns that should have a direct impact on Cllr's decision. So I therefore ask Cllr to support the proposals as set out.
Thanks. Okay, thanks George. I'm going to bring Ann back in because Ann's a ward councillor, so just like to ask Ann to say a few words.
Yeah, thanks Phil. I'll start off. I am a ward councillor, but I sat on the board with BBCHA for 9 years until I was timed out by the HCA rules, which was just over 18 months ago. And since then, councillor pulled out, he has taken that seat on the board. Just a bit of background to this, I was there when in 2005 when the state voted no to go with Wirral Partnership Homes, voted to go on its own, to go as a small independent.